chapters, right?
Okay, let's get started. Today we are going to continue our discussion on weak plurality theorem, and we'll also talk about under what conditions there are no duality gaps, in particular for convex problems with linear constraints, and under certain conditions there is no duality gap. So we'll talk a little bit about some of those conditions. So if you recall, my primary problem was I want to minimize f of x such that g of x is less than or equal to 0. Let me add an equality constraint as well, because so that I can cover the topic of what happens when there is equality constraint at the same time. The dual problem is x is in Rn. The dual problem is I want to maximize q of mu comma lambda. Mu is greater than or equal to 0. Lambda is in Rm. And you want to make sure that q of mu and lambda is greater than minus infinity. So you want to avoid the set of mu comma lambda where the value of q is negative infinity. And I'll show you through example how exactly you identify those sets. And how do you define q of mu comma lambda? Well, that is minimum or infimum x is in Rn. Let me make x is in capital X because we are being general here. L of x So, what does weak duality theorem say? Weak duality theorem says that q star is always less than or equal to f star. So this value is always lower than or equal to this value. Now, when q star is equal to f star, we say that there is no duality. Yeah. And when q star is strictly less than f star, then we say that there is a duality gap. That's the difference between when there is no duality gap and when there is a duality gap. look at two situations when there is no duality here. The first situation is, I want to define f of x such that ax equal to b, cx less than equal to b, and f is convex. In this case, there is no duality. F is convex and f star is finite. So if your problem has a solution and f is convex, then there is no duality gap. Okay, so this is the first situation when there is no duality gap, when f is convex and these are of course linear constraints. Then one can show using some mathematical theory that q star will always be equal to f star, so there is no duality gap. Now let's look at the second condition. I want to minimize f of x such that g of x is less than or equal to 0. X is in some capital set X, and I'm going to make the following assumption. Convex closed set, F is convex, and there exists a X bar and X such that G of X bar is strictly less than 0 for all J. So GJ is also convex. F is convex, GJ is convex. Everything is convex here. You have a convex set, you have convex functions. Yes.
So like, this is another example, right? So there is also no duality gap.
This one? Yes, there is no duality gap.
So, like, what is the difference between these two?
These two? The only difference is this is slightly more general because here x is in Rn and these are called what is known as polyhedral set. So they are like a cube or a hexagon or a pentagon like shapes, whereas this one is far more general. You have a convex set, you have convex functions over convex set, and this G could be like a circle, like not a circle, a sphere, right? So sphere is not taken care of by this expression. That's not a, that's, you cannot write a spherical constraint as a set of equalities and inequalities, right? So you can have sphere here as a constraint, and but as a sphere is fine as long as there is an x bar at which all gj of x bar is less than 0. Okay, so this is known as Slater constraint qualification, this particular condition. So as long as you have an x bar such that for every j, gj of x bar is less than 0, then there is no duality gap. If this constraint is violated, you may have a duality gap. Remember that when you have no duality gap, it's very easy for you to come up with a certificate of optimality, because you can look at Q of mu k, you can look at F of xk. If the difference between them is small, you are very close to the optimal solution, otherwise you are far away from the optimal solution. If you have a duality gap, that number could be very large, could be very small, and there is no way for you to know whether you are close to the optimal solution or not. So ideally, you always want to, so you have an optimization problem which may be very complex, you always want to transform it into some other approximate optimization problem. Like you will have some objective function, some constraint, you want to transform them into a convex objective function with convex constraints, which are approximations of the original functions, so that you have no duality gap and you can solve this problem easily, which would be an approximately optimal solution to your original problem. So that's typically the recipe for solving very complicated optimization problems. So I use these kind of ideas a lot in my research. I have a very complicated optimization problem, like scheduling a million electric vehicles using renewable energy, very complicated 24-hour long or 48-hour long optimization problem. I want to try and come up with an approximate optimization problem that is convex. And once it is convex, I can actually come up with very simple algorithms to solve the problem. By simple, I mean that if I have to schedule 1 million electric vehicles for 48-hour period, I can do it in 1 hour or 1.5 hours of computation. So that's a simple computation, right? If I wanted to do that using the original optimization formulation, it would have taken me 1 million years to schedule like 1 million electric vehicles for the 24-hour period, for 48-hour period. So as you can see, you have the original problem, very complicated, highly non-convex problem. You want to transform it into a convex problem because you want to leverage this no duality gap condition. You come up with an algorithm to solve it, which becomes an approximately optimal solution to the original problem you wanted to solve. Okay. In signal processing, you have, brain images or some movement of whatever, movement of muscles or heart or whatever. And they also try to transform their original non-convex problem into a convex problem, solve it, which becomes an approximate optimal solution to the original problem. So that's typically why people would do it, and that's because in convex problems, the duality gap is zero. So a lot of, it's very easy for you to certify that you have reached an optimal solution. Okay, any questions so far?
So,
yes.
So the complexity here is in the constraints.
So here, I don't know what you mean by complexity. The complexity is always in the algorithm, not in the formulation. So let's say I give you an optimization problem,
yeah,
and you give me an output xk.
Mm-hmm.
How do I know xk is close to optimal, far from optimal?
Mm-hmm.
How do you certify it? If it is convex,
mm-hmm,
then you will say f of xk minus q of mu k is 10 raised to minus 6. then I know that you are very close to the optimal, right?
Mm-hmm.
If it is non-convex and you tell me that,
yeah,
then also I know you are close to the optimum because,
okay,
because your f of xk minus q of uk is small. If you have a duality gap and it turns out to be 100, how do I know you are close to optimal or not? Right?
Yeah.
There is a duality gap, there is nothing I can do about it. Right? And as I have mentioned, so in the electricity market example that you have worked on, it takes 3 hours to schedule generators for 24-hour period. And the duality gap is about 1% or 1.5% of f of x star, right? So that is considered a good solution, okay? 1% of f of x star, that's a good solution. But remember that each 0.1% means $1 million, okay? So it's a lot of money that is at stake. So you want to get as close to optimal as possible because you can save $1 million. Who will save? We will save. We as consumers of electricity will save $1 million. Collectively. So each of us will only save 10 cents, but collectively all of us will save $1 million. Right? So that's why this notion of duality gap is very, very, very useful. And I know many of you are sort of first year students here, but assuming you go on to individual fields, and if you went into electricity market, for instance, if you work in power systems area, this is something that you will work on day in and day out. Okay, this is every time you are solving a complicated optimization problem, you want to find out what is an estimate on f of f star minus q star. Okay, because that becomes a certificate of optimality in most of those optimization problems. Any questions? Okay, so now what I'm going to do, I'm going to erase that side of the board. I'm going to start with the primal problem and I'm going to show you how do we construct dual problem. So I do it for a linear programming problem and then I do it for maybe quadratic programming problem as well. Any questions on this side? I wrote these two cases where there is no duality gap, then in those situations the optimal geometric multipliers are the same as Lagrange multipliers. So the numerical values of Lagrange multipliers and geometric multipliers are the same in those cases. Many a times when you are writing papers, people tend to confuse between geometric multipliers and Lagrange multipliers. They will use the term interchangeably for convex problems, and the reason for that is they are the same as long as there is no duality gap. Okay. So, but in reality, in practice, the notion of geometric multipliers is quite different from the notion of Lagrange multipliers. You can have geometric multipliers for optimization of a discrete set, but you cannot define Lagrange multipliers for optimization over discrete sets because you cannot differentiate the functions if they are only defined at discrete set of points. So very important distinction between geometric multiplier and Lagrange multiplier. Okay, so let's look at the following example. I want to minimize C transpose X. X is in Rn. Ax is equal to B. I need to also make the assumption that x is greater than or equal to 0. Okay. Let me define capital X as x in Rn such that x is greater than or equal to 0. Okay, so I'm absorbing this constraint into the set capital X. Okay, just out of my preference. I could treat it as an inequality constraint, or I could treat it in the set capital X itself. So I'm going to treat it within the set capital X. The next step is to construct the Lagrangian, which is C transpose X plus lambda transpose B minus X. What should I do now? What's the next step? A transpose. What should I do now? I have to construct a dual problem. I have to solve this minimization problem. Yes?
Is there any reason that when you set up your h of x to be equal to 0, you did b minus x instead of x minus b? Is there
yes.
a difference?
The reason is the final expression will look cool. If I take it the other way, it won't look that cool. We can do that in the next round, okay? Just to see how uncool the expression looks. If I take it the other way. Okay. What should I do next? I have to do this infimum, right? So let's try to solve this infimum problem. So I want to do infimum of L of x lambda such that x is greater than or equal to 0. So this x, I have to minimize this expression, lambda transpose b plus something transpose x, for x greater than or equal to 0. How should I do that? So what happens when this thing is non-negative? So I'll split it into two cases, c minus a transpose lambda is greater than or equal to 0. What would the minimum value of the Lagrangian be? And Ci minus A transpose lambda I is less than 0 for some I. So either all the vectors for a fixed lambda, either all vectors in this vector are non-negative, or there exists at least one element of the vector which is negative, right? So these are the only two cases that will happen. So what's the minimum here?
Lambda transpose b.
Yes. Lambda transpose b, and why is that?
The minimum along x is x equals to 0.
Yeah, so we will pick x equals, so these are all called non-negative entries. So if I pick x equal to 0, I'm restricted to all points x greater than or equal to 0. So if I pick x equal to 0, that's the minimum value because this term gets killed. In the other case, what happens? So one of the elements of this vector is negative. What would the infimum look like? So C minus A transpose lambda one minus one. Okay, and I want to minimize one minus one transpose x, not transpose. One minus one times x for x greater than or equal to 0. What would the infimum be?
Minus infinity.
minus infinity. So I can always pick x2 equals to plus infinity, which will make this whole term minus infinity. And that would be the infimum value. Like minus infinity is the lowest infimum can get, right? It can't get below minus infinity. I mean, there's nothing known as, there's no number below minus infinity. So this is going to be minus infinity. Okay, any questions in this step? Okay. So now what should I do? Well, I'm restricted to all the points where q mu comma lambda is greater than minus infinity. So I'm only restricting myself to the value of lambda such that c minus a transpose lambda is greater than or equal to 0. So let us call this set b. So b equals to lambda such that c minus a transpose lambda is greater than or equal to 0. And then the dual problem is going to be, I want to minimize lambda transpose b. Or maybe b transpose lambda, I think that looks better. Such that a transpose lambda is less than equal to c. Lambda is an Rn. Rn. This is the dual problem.
Can you repeat from d?
Where? D?
Yeah.
So remember here, I'm restricted to picking mu and lambda such that q is greater than minus infinity. So in this case, if I have any of these terms strictly less than 0, then this is minus infinity, so I have to avoid this class of lambda. So for what values of lambda do I have a finite infima? Well, that's when c minus a transpose lambda is greater than or equal to 0. That's this case. And now I can construct the dual problem using this approach. Question? Okay, so let's look at the sequence of steps again. I have the primal problem, I construct the Lagrangian, I take the infimum over all x, and then I figure out what the set of feasible values of mu and lambda is, and then I am going to write the dual problem. Okay, that's the sequence of steps. So let's follow that sequence of steps here. I have the primal problem, I constructed my set capital X as x greater than or equal to 0. I wrote the expression for Lagrangian, which turns out to be this expression here. Then I did the infima of L of x comma lambda. This gives me q of lambda. And that is given by lambda transpose b under some condition, minus infinity under some other conditions. Now, because it's minus infinity in these conditions, I'm going to throw out those values of lambda. And I'm just going to consider the values of lambda that satisfies this constraint. And that's my set D here. That's how I constructed the set D. And then I pick Q of, this should be maximum. So now, please make the correction, this should be maximum. So now, I have to maximize Q of lambda such that lambda is in D. This is lambda is in D, and lambda is in Rn. Now there was a question, what happens when I pick Ax minus b? So I'm going to do that very quickly, but you don't have to note it down. Okay, so I'm not going to wait for you to note it down. So let's change this constraint to Ax minus b, so I have a transpose lambda plus c. That's right. So c plus a transpose lambda, no, minus lambda transpose b. Okay, now it looks correct. So when c plus a transpose lambda is greater than or equal to 0, I have minus lambda transpose b. When one of them is negative, then I have minus infinity. So b should be c plus a transpose lambda greater than or equal to 0. And then the dual problem is I want to minimize, maximize minus b transpose lambda such that a transpose lambda is greater than or equal to minus c and lambda is an Rm. So this is what my dual problem looks like with too many negative signs, so that's why it's uncool. The formulation is uncool. For some reason, people in optimization don't want to see negative signs in the final solution. Okay. But this is a valid dual problem. Don't get me wrong. This is a valid dual problem. It's just that the expressions don't look good. That's it. But it's a valid dual problem. It's not incorrect. So if you write in the exam, or whatever, not exam, but even in your life, if this is a dual problem you came up with, it's completely fine. Don't be alarmed that it doesn't look good. Okay. Any questions? Yes.
So if you have an inequality constraint,
yes,
like if you incorporate that in the Lagrangian,
right,
it's going to be...
Yes, that's a good question. So he's saying, let me pick x to be in Rn. Let me pick x to be in Rn, and I'm going to keep this inequality constraint as is. Then my Lagrangian would change. I'll have a mu term here. C transpose x plus lambda plus no minus mu transpose x. Okay, and we'll have to go through the whole process to get some final expression here. Do you want to do that? Do you want to find the final expression for this case? Let's do that. Why not? Let's try to do that. Okay, so this is, I have to correct all the terms with x together. Let me make it b minus ax. So I have lambda transpose b plus c minus a transpose lambda minus mu transpose x. So I have q of lambda comma mu is b q of mu comma lambda. This would be lambda transpose b transpose b is c minus a transpose equals to zero, and this is minus infinity. Other side. Okay, so when this is equal to zero, then this term gets killed, and the value is lambda transpose x. But if this term is non-zero, I can pick x appropriately, either plus infinity or minus infinity, so as to get the value minus infinity for the integral. Okay, and now I can formulate the dual problem, which would be, I want to maximize lambda transpose b such that c minus a transpose lambda minus b equals to 0. Lambda would be in Rn and mu would be in Rr and mu would be greater than equal to 0. No, mu would be in Rn.
Equal to 0?
Greater than equal to.
No, I mean, C, A transpose.
Yes, this is equal to 0. See? That is the constraint. This is the objective. And this is the usual stuff. Either this term is zero, in which case I have a finite value, or one of this vector is non-zero, in which case I get minus infinity. Okay. In the previous case, this x was greater than or equal to zero. Okay, so I was only restricted to picking a positive value of x. Now I'm unrestricted. I can pick any value of x I want. X is an Rn. So that's the difference. Any other question? Okay, so let's do a quadratic programming problem and see what the dual problem looks like. Now there is one quadratic programming problem that's part of your assignment, so I'm not going to solve that part. I'm going to do the other with inequality constraint. Okay, so I'm going to erase this side. Any questions? Now Q of mu is supposed to be the infimum of x is Rn of L of x comma mu. How do I compute the infimum here for this problem? Yes.
Take the derivative with respect to x, set it equal to zero.
And why would that give me infimum?
Because x is in Rn.
That is true, but there is another reason why this would give me the infimum and not just a stationary point.
Because it's convex.
Because the Lagrangian is convex in x. So this term is actually linear in x. This term is linear in x. This term is strongly convex in x. So therefore, Lagrangian is strongly convex in x. So I take the first derivative, set it equal to 0, I get x star. And then I have to plug the value into this expression to get the value of L of x star. So let's do that. So I got the value of x star at which this infimum is achieved. This is just the first derivative setting it equal to 0. Now I have to substitute this x star in this expression so as to get the value, infimum value of this Lagrangian. So let's do that. What is L of x star comma mu? That is half of, oh my god, I'm getting a headache now. This is going to be a long calculation. Okay guys, bear with me. I have to do this long calculation. Let's do it, whatever. C plus A transpose mu transpose Q inverse C plus A transpose mu plus, actually it's not that bad. C plus A transpose mu transpose minus Q inverse C plus A transpose mu and then minus mu transpose. Oh, it's not that bad as I thought it would be. Okay. Any questions on this step? So how do I simplify it? So Q and Q inverse gets cancelled here. And I have plus half multiplied by some term and then minus that term. So I actually get Q of mu minus C plus A transpose mu. questions so far? I want to write it, I want to transform this expression in a little bit, just to make it look good, which is half mu transpose q inverse, no, mu transpose a q inverse a transpose mu. And the dual problem would be, I want to maximize this over mu greater than equal to 0. Does this look correct? I hope it is.
Can you just repeat it once, like how q mu is coming?
How q mu is?
Like near that line.
This line?
Yeah.
Okay. So I have half of this term, and then I have a negative sign here, so I can take this negative sign outside. This becomes a negative sign. And I have the same term that was on the top, I have the same term in the bottom as well. So I just did that calculation. And then I have minus mu transpose v here, which goes here. Okay? So in the assignment, you just have to change this equality with inequality with equality, and you have to follow the same process and get to the dual problem. In the case of equality constraint, this dual problem, you will have lambda, and lambda can take any value in Rm. Okay, so lambda will be in Rm in your case, and you will have q of lambda, which will be some expression here on this side. Now, my question is, if I ask you, well, I'm not going to ask you in this course, but in the future, if someone asks you to solve this problem, how will you solve this problem? So this is an optimization of a concave function. So remember, this is maximization of a negative quadratic function. So it's actually a concave function. So you are optimizing a concave function over a convex set. Okay? So you can use any of the methods we have talked about, manifold suboptimization method, gradient projection method, conditional gradient method, and so on, to solve this problem. Now, is this set easy to project on? Mu greater than equal to 0? Is it an easy set to project on? It is, right? Because we have studied how the projection on this particular set works. We can use the gradient projection method to solve this problem numerically, okay, if you are asked to do that ever in your life. So even though for this problem you will have to use manifold suboptimization method to solve this, which is a very complicated algorithm, as you have found out the hard way, this one is comparatively much easier to solve. any questions so far on duality? The other thing to note here is that this is a convex objective function with linear constraint. There is no duality gap in this problem. As long as it has, well, I think it will always have a solution. So this problem, you will always have a solution, and therefore you will never have a duality gap here. Okay. So that's all I have on static optimizations. We have completed the syllabus on static optimization problems so far. In the next class, we are going to talk about dynamic optimization problems. And what we will see in the next class is you can view dynamic optimization problem either as a static optimization problem with constraints, or you can view it as a dynamic problem. And based on these fundamental thoughts, we will come up with two different solution approaches. One which is treating the dynamic problem as a dynamic problem, and the other one which is treating the dynamic problem as a static problem. So we'll come up with these two approaches, and we'll talk about it for the rest of the semester until the semester ends on 8th of December. So until then, we are just going to talk about dynamic optimization. Thank you for your attention. See you on Wednesday.